Some friends and I in a public house were playing dominoes one night. Into the room the barman came, his face all chalky white. "What's up?" says Brown. "Have you seen a ghost? Have you seen your Aunt Mariah?" "Oh, me Aunt Mariah be buggered," said he, "the bloody pub's on fire."
As he leans into her and she gives in all trust. "I hate that fucking cow." "There's nothing he wouldn't do for her." After he's heaved and hauled and rocked her out, single-minded, 3 hours it took him. Nobody bothered with the ropes. They brought him 6 bottles of beer and bags of sandwiches instead. Day out it was. He's standing on the road getting clapped on the back and sinking the bottles in one. And I says to him, "What's she called?" "The cow. What's her name?" And he bursts out laughing at me. "She hasn't got a name, you daft bitch. But the breed's Charolais." And I know it was a stupid thing to ask him, but what was I supposed to say? "Me insides aren't right from watching you. I'm thick with rage and wanting you. I hate that fucking cow. I hate her soft face and her solid head and her dirty yellow tags up against your sweaty neck like cheap gold earrings." The two of ye pressed together. One big, long, heavy muscled animal. "Take me home. Hold me down. Because if I have to look at your square shoulders underneath a t-shirt one more time, I'll explode. I'll fucking explode." Charolais. Nice name though, isn't it? For a girl. If it is a girl. "You're not calling any child of mine after a heifer," he goes. But I thought, I'll get around him. Sure, it's too nice of a name not to use it. I need something with it though, for balance. I like Charolais Rose. That was me mammy's name. The rose bit. Me dad was called Bob. Charolais Bob doesn't work. For a boy or a girl. I wish I could tell them though, Mum and Dad, about the baby. I don't believe in all that talking to the air nonsense. When you're dead, you're dead. Just gone. Sure, they were nice to me when they were here. Always on my side, no matter who said what about me, and thinking that's better than crying or putting flowers on the grave. I don't like the grave. Don't like feeling empty. Sure, I just missed them. I tell you one thing, they'd have put Breeda in her place in jig time. Breeda. Horrible fucking name, isn't it? Why would you do that to a child? You can't call a child that and not have her turn out the wateriest old streak of misery ever going. Skinny, no mating her at all. Gives her that look of her mouth being too big for her face. Do you know that kind of way? She's got too tight, curly, grey hair, and she smells of old furniture. And she's a bitch too, Jimmy's ma. Thundering old bitch. There's a wasp in her, but it's all covered up. Smiling at you one minute, giving you a swipe the next. You wouldn't trust her now, you would not. When I came here first, last year, she was obsessed with the work I was doing for Jimmy, looking over my shoulder the whole time on the laptop, her gammy eyes staring out from over the top of her glasses, her two eyes point in different directions, so you never know where to look. She's squinting and quizzing me the whole time. What's that you're filling in, Siobhan? The size of your fields without the bushes and roads and yards and stuff. The area aid map. She nearly had a conniption. He has you doing that now, as well as the herd register. Show me that. Doesn't look right to me at all. Jimmy done the numbers, Breeda. I'm just typing them in. Well, what do you call that thing? A spreadsheet. A spreadsheet. Did you learn that in your course? Imagine, they let you on that now without the leaving cert and everything. Didn't you fall on your feet? Don't who? Fall on me feet, me foot. If anyone's doing well out of this, I wanted to say, it's you, Breeda Keane. And the false course paying my wages to come up here gluing this for you. Oh, I said nothing. And I let the leaving cert swipe go too. I just thought, oh yeah. She'll get what's coming to her. And in the meantime, I'll have my secret. Me own private man that sends me looks that keep me quiet. Turns his body to mine in dark corners and black fields and back seats. He bit me once on the knuckle in the kitchen when Breeda's back was turned. And I knew then he wanted to take me and eat me up. Show me off as his. It's just that he can't because of her. So we do it in secret. Jimmy loves doing it in the middle shed with the galvanised roof where they keep the turf. He gets the thrill of doing it so close to the house. I like the smell of the turf, but I can never really relax. And then we have to do it quick in case the cyclops catches us. My favourite is underneath the spindle tree, miles away from anyone, above in Norway, the farthest field. I'd never seen them trees before. You wouldn't believe it. They've bright pink flowers, but in the middle of every one there's a seed, and that's bright orange. Near the end of the summer, we were up there, and in the middle of everything, Jimmy reaches up, grabs hold of a branch above me head, gives it a rattle. All petals and seeds come flying down. The two of us trying not to burst out laughing. He's actually more romantic than he knows. And then, on the days when it was raining, we just used the sleeping bag laid out in the back of the Jeep. In the beginning of the summer, when I first came to work here, before we got together, like, me and Jimmy be driving round the fields, marking up the herd register. Hardly a word between us. He's painfully shy, like. And I thought, well, that Breeda one never shuts up. Think I'll give his ears a rest. So we'd go off to each field. Him calling out the numbers on the cow's ear tags, and me writing them down in the blue book. Sometimes I'd catch him looking at me, and me stomach would flip. I used to look at that sleeping bag and be dying for him to just leap on me. Weeks and weeks went by, and nothing. And And every day we'd drive back to the farmhouse and I'd head home, me head wrecked, thinking, when in the name of God is he just going to kiss me? Halfway back to town one evening, I couldn't take it anymore. So I turned round and I headed back. I didn't know exactly what I was going to say to him, really. I just knew I couldn't stick another minute of not having him. By the time I got back up there, I decided on a date. I'm going to ask him out on a date. Well, it's after 7, so Breed'll be watching telly, and he hates the soaps. Chances are he's out in one of the sheds. Well, I definitely had a guardian angel that day, because I found him straight away. He was out in the hay shed, leaning up against a bale, having a wank. Swear to God. Sure, it all made sense to me then. He's been thinking the same as me the whole way along. I stood there, watching him for a bit. And I kind of thought to myself, I don't think this is the right time to ask him out on a date. So instead, I said, I'll do that for you if you want. He opened his eyes and pinned me with this look like he was going to kill me. And then, for a tiny second, like he didn't know what kind of creature I was at all, afraid nearly. He caught himself quick though, stuck out his hand and pulled me in and onto the hay. And the rest, as they say, is history. Except in halfway through, I hear this strange kind of rustling. I look up, half expecting to see Breeda. But instead, here's this giant, blonde, hairy head taking chunks out of the hay bale, chomping away, getting a grand old eyeful. Big slimy tongue hanging out. She's so close. I swear I can feel her breath on my arm and I kind of freeze. Jimmy looks up, doesn't miss a beat. Hup, get away! And she saunters off across the yard. The sound of her hooves fading away, I can breathe out again. Jimmy leans back over me, gives me a wink. Awful nosy. Dem Charolais.
Quand il me prend dans ses bras, il me parle tout bas, je vois le lion rose. Oulala,
the farmer is bullying, n'est-ce pas? Dining al fresco, eh, farmer?
Oof.
Pleasant evening for it, I suppose. Very few flies. Romantic sunset. Hey, ooh la la. The bird song at twilight. The dusk chorus. Amazing, no? Magnifique. To bid the day adieu and greet the night avec quelle joie de vivre. Such a, how you say? Gusto. Very moving, no? All those birdy voices raised up in song. May, poor little sparrow, soon the hedge will need a trim and poof, your little nest in tatters. All the heads lopped off your squeaking little gutterbeak babies. Comme le guillotine, n'est-ce pas? And that brute, the farmer, who will not care, who will not notice, lolloping round, scratching himself, smelling of sweat and boiled ovine, spitting and swearing and such rough hands. No finesse. He will massacre your petite famille, tiny birdie. And yet, you are luckier than me, for you have wings and can flee this place. And the crushing ennui. I fear I may expire for lack of occupation.
How I long for conversation.
These other cattle, my so-called companions, but they are barely coherent. It is not their fault, no. Impoverished, crossbred mongrels. Pas comme moi.
La charolaise.
No, we cannot relate. And so I keep my distance, making my daily promenade toute seule. This, bien sûr, incurs the unwanted attention of the oaf. He promises a mate to alleviate the tedium when I am bullying, as he says, so base, so grotesque. Still, I look forward to a fine calf sired by a bull of excellent pedigree. And so, I shall not succumb to the despair, no. I shall endure.
Quand il me prend dans ses bras, il me parle tout bas. Je vois le vieux en rossoir.
All this blah, blah, blah is making me peckish, no? Une midnight snack, peut-être. Ah oui. Where the grass is fresh and fine, pretty cow goes there to dine.
I had it all planned to tell him. Get in early, cook him up a big breakfast, then, you know, he'd be in better humour for it. But when I get in, there's the two of them, himself and herself, Breeda, the ma, sitting at the table with all dirty plates and all. Oh, you're fed, I says. Oh, he is, she says. Right. What you have, Jimmy? Bit of birthday cake, two flakes and a bit of a fry. I could have scrob in her face. Birthday cake. Birthday cake? It's not even his birthday. He means brack. How the fuck can I compete with that? Had to buy a block of ice cream. Waited all day, went down to Hennessy's, bought a Hazelbrook Farm vanilla and he ate it all after his dinner. He does love his food, so he does. Then after his cup of tea, went out to the sheds and I followed him out, told him then about the baby. He effed and blinded for a bit, put his foot through a bag of feed, then went real quiet for ages. You're having it, I suppose. Nothing else for it. Huh. Kicking the gut from a heifer put pay to it.
Jeez.
He was only joking, though. I know he was.
That'd be a sense of humour, like.
Eventually he goes, probably bound to happen sooner or later. You've not to tell Mam they've hurt to me. Then we done it up against the cattle crush. And I love that about him. He just gets things done. Quiet, like. He'll tell her, he will, in his own time, in his own way. Still though, I can't help thinking I'd have loved him to just drop it on her. Right in the middle of her favourite telly or something. Emmerdale. No, the Angelas. The shock of it might send her into an early grave. You never know your luck. For ages I've been thinking about all the different ways she might pop her clogs. Apart from the eye, she's as healthy as a feckin' horse. Doesn't drink, doesn't smoke, barely a wrinkle from never cracking a smile in her life. Fuck's sake, she'll end up dying of nothing when she's 90. I'd be trying to think of ways to help her along, you know. Sure, all you ever hear is farms or death traps. Bale of hay on the head. Little nudge. Close to the slurry pit. Still though. Feckin' CSI, you wouldn't chance it. No, a little bit of an accident, that's the way to go. And there's ways and means. Have you ever seen a farmer wearing a scarf? No, you have not. Too many things to get caught in. Diggers and generators and hay balers.
Guess what I'm giving Breeder for Christmas? Oh yeah, a nice one too, ornate with green tassels on it. Took me time picking it out. And then I think I'll give her another one for her birthday. Her birthday's in January. And she can't say a feckin' thing, because I'm getting her a present, haven't I? Ah yeah, like I said, you just never know. Sure, I've been lucky enough to fall in love, haven't I?
Parlez-moi d'amour, redites-moi des choses tendres, parlez-moi d'amour.
The day has come, the hour, it is now, finalement. I am to meet my mate, mon ami.
Où est-il? Where is he?
Regardez-moi. All the excitement of the coquettish young thing. I imagine him for so long and soon he is here. I am almost too jumping beside my skin.
Mon amour, mon chéri, he will be strong, of the highest pedigree. Good conformation. No stout or stumpy bull for me. Ooh,
he will be alert and creamy white. May no? Perhaps wheaten in colour. I am not opposed to the more exotic of our breed. Quelle bonne surprise, no?
Ooh la la. I imagine his exquisite muscling, his excellent loins. I go weak at the thought of his deep hind quarter. Oui!
A superior specimen as befits my own breeding. I am no snob, but my calf must be sired by the best. No ordinary beast will do, even the oaf knows that, for he will want an handsome calf, and so I shall get an handsome bull.
Oh, I am so, how you say, horny.
He came thundering in. I didn't know what was happening. I thought maybe he was after telling herself and she let fly or something. Turns out one of the heifers went missing and he seen her halfway up the rag field away from the herd. Animal on its own usually means it's sick, so he says anyway. And I know that's never good. But he's gone mad altogether, effing and blinding, banging cups and presses till Breeder comes running in. What in the name of God? There's a cow sick, I says to her. He's taking it real bad. And why wouldn't he? It's our livelihood, Chavot. Stupid girl. She turns to Jimmy. Which heifer is it, she wants to know. But before he can answer, I get in. Do you think it might be TBE, Jimmy?
Jesus Christ!
She reared up on me altogether then. TBE. T.B. Is there a want in you? Don't even mention that word. She doesn't understand, ma'am. You're not helping, Siobhan. Go and make us a pot of tea or something, will you? And he brings her off into the sitting room. I flick on the kettle thinking, fuck, fuck, fuck. I'm going to have to apologise to that old bag now and I don't even know what I'm after doing. I headed into the good room with some tea and the Swiss roll. And she seemed to have calmed down. I'm sorry, Breed. If I said something wrong, it's fine. It's fine. You weren't to know. And you a townie. We'll put it in the past. But it's an awful thing to think of. TB. 'Twould have given anyone a fright. Farming is tough, Siobhan. But at least you have your animals. TB. Losing the herd. Losing the whole herd.
Well, you've no idea what that's like. The loneliness, the isolation. It's like...
Like Helen Keller, I said. The two of them just stared at me. I thought, oh wait, no. Helen Keller and Anne Frank. I always get those two mixed up. Oh, I can never figure it out, so I stuck with Helen Keller. So, anyway, sure, you get me gist. Breed a truer eyes up to heaven. Jesus, wait. Gawain, leave us to it now, Siobhan, will you? And they chatted it out. I kept an ear cocked from the kitchen. It's the Charolais that went missing. Well, now I understand it. She sneezes sideways, he has a heart attack. Could cost him thousands, they say. Not to mind losing the calf as well. He had her inseminated a while back with this sex semen stuff that they use. Jesus, I don't know. Needed to make sure everything went to plan and the calf would be a bull. I felt sorry for her, actually, even though I hate her, the cow. When the AI man came to inseminate, I mean, like, who wants a giant needle up the you-know-what instead of the real thing? Over in seconds, and bam, sure enough, she's pregnant. And 2 months later, so am I. And I'm not even going to pretend to myself that Jimmy wasn't happier about the cow, because he was. Oh, yeah. Came bounding into the kitchen to tell Breeder the cow's having a bye. And he hasn't even told her we're an item, not to mind up the pole. I'm going to start showing soon. She might be blind in one eye, but she's not thick. Anyway, he gulps down the rest of his tea, tea leaves and all. Sometimes I think I'm going out with a feckin' savage. Jumps up, grabs his fleece, mumbling something about grass tetany, whatever that is, some cow disease, I suppose, and stomps back through the kitchen. Here, come here, I says. We'll go with you. Moral support. Money dying to get a look at her, see if things are as bad as he says. Inside in the Jeep, I says to him, I felt real stupid when you said I wasn't helping. Ah, Jesus, not now, Siobhan, no. I want to help. I want to understand. And I never want to have to apologise to your ma again. So he told me. The whole herd wiped out in 1987. He was 13, and he remembers the bumps under the cattle skin and his father's face. And the day the lorries came and took the herd. His dad didn't last much longer after that. That left Breeda and himself. She was only 45. Little by little, she just turned a bit cranky. And I'm listening to him talk, probably more than he ever has before in one go. All about the quietness. No gates rattling. No cows calling. No need to start the tractor. The lonely life of the farmer. I wish he didn't feel that. He doesn't have to be lonely. Neither of us do anymore. Jimmy. I love you. I waited. Your heart in me mouth. Oh, we better see to this Charolais. Yeah. He had other things on his mind, though. Didn't he?
Imbecile! Putain, c'est pas vrai. Oh la vache, bordel de merde. Bastard. Tyrant. Farmer, off. May your testicles pickle in their own juice. Je ne comprends pas. The agony, the humiliation, the indignity. Le AI man avec la syringe. Merde!
C'est vrai. L'amour, ça sert à quoi? What good is love? L'amour! It is all tears and suffering, no? I would die of a broken heart. But for the second heart that beats inside me now. And alas, I have no joy. For what will I tell my little calf when he asks Maman? Who is mon papa? Je ne sais pas, mon petit chou. Pierre, François, Serge, Rémi, Pascal, Marcel, Didier, Guy, je ne sais pas. Quelle tristesse. Triste. Vraiment. Triste.
Parlez-moi d'amour. Réditez-moi des choses tendres. Parlez-moi d'amour.
Jesus fucking Christ. There is nothing wrong with that cow. She's putting on a great show, though. Off by herself, a bit wobbly on the feet, off her feed. Jimmy jumps over the gate. Wait there, he says to me. Like I'm going anywhere in my condition. Bad enough rattling around in this shite arse jeep on the way up here. This kid's going to come out damaged, I'm telling you. Here leaves the keys, I says, it's freezing. And he locks them back in the window, sorry. And I thought, good. I'm glad you're sorry. Didn't even think I existed there for a minute. He goes plodding up the field. Looks about half the size with the weight of the worry. Buckets of magnesium pulling him down. And I half want to run up and hug him, but I mostly want to kill him. Because where was he last week when I was getting my scan? Not worrying about my swollen ankles, are you? Maybe if I went on hunger strike like the cow, you'd sit up and take notice. But that's never going to happen. I'm feckin' starving the whole time. I stick the key in the ignition, start her up. Sound of the engine gives the cow a little skitter.
Mon Dieu, laissez-moi tranquille.
And Jimmy glares back at me. Oh my God. About halfway up, he gives a little call to her. And she turns her huge head. And I swear, kind of cocks her arse around as well. Like she's posing on the red carpet. But delighted with herself all silky and golden and feckin' superior. Jesus, Beyonce isn't in it with her. Well, go on, swish your tail. After about 40 minutes and nuzzles and rubs, the two of them exchange in secrets. She's grand again, brand fucking new, lashes into the mineral feed like there's no tomorrow. Jimmy stands back to watch. She's tick. And wide and plump. Her legs are strong, set real far apart. Every bit of her is firm and fleshy. Soft skin, pink nose, heavy breath. Nothing is going to ruin her day. And the line of her back. She's just perfect. Like she really is a beautiful cow. For fuck's sake. I think I might have hormones or something. Anyway, this is not good for the baby. Getting all stressed out. Oh, the nurse says I have to practice me mindfulness and join the pregnant yoga class. I did that. They're on for free in the parish hall, which is A1. But they're run by the ICA, which is shite. Eleanor Phelan is teaching it. And she's on the Tools for Solidarity in Tanzania committee with Breida. And don't tell me they don't talk. She Breida get blood from a stone. I don't want her knowing about me pelvic floor. I don't want her knowing about Anton down there. Jesus Christ. There's nowhere I can go to get away from her. This is not good for the baby. This is not good for the baby. So I'm going to stop and concentrate on me breathing. Take me brain to a happy, peaceful place. Electric fence. No. Slurry pit. Maybe. Heart attack? Not a stroke. Hey, Baylor. Stampede. Natural causes? Oh, feckin' euthanasia. Now, if Beyonce could do Breida in, that'd be the two birds with the one stone right there. Ah, feckin' fat chance. And you know how hard it is to get information on how to kill a cow? Seriously, like, who'd you ask without drawing attention to yourself? Jimmy, say if I wanted to murder that dirty big Goldie slut up there in the field. How would I go about it, eh? Oh, bearing in mind now that I'm heavily pregnant with your giant baby and all. I was getting desperate. I mean, the only ways I can come up with are kind of dodgy. Like, first, I reckoned, couldn't I just slit her throat? I'd have to get her by herself into the cattle crush, so she'd be stuck, not able to move, but that could be done. Feed her a bucket of nuts, she'd follow me into the shed. She likes nuts. Fucking spoilt rotten. Then, after she'd be in there and I'd have her head trapped and all, would I be able to cut into her neck? I don't know if I could manage it. It's tough now, cowhide, so it is. I mean, cow skins are like leather. But then, I got a bit of a brainwave on my last trip to the hospital. The nurse was taking me blood, and I thought, sure, I'd only have to nick a vein, bleed her out. Beyonce now, not the nurse. So I nipped into Sheehan's on the way home, and I bought this. Oh. See, this would make the cut, no bother. And then, I could stick in this. And widen it. And widen it. And widen it. That'd work. It'd be hard and really, really feckin' messy. Like we're talking buckets of blood pumping out of her. I'd be soaked in it. She'd be thrashing around making an awful racket. Oh, I don't know, the noise and the clean-up. And how would I get rid of the body? Seriously, cows are a dead weight. I don't know. I haven't ruled it out. I hold on to this, but for Jesus' sake, there has to be an easier way. I mean, the stupid animals are falling down dead day in, day out when you don't want them to. And I was afraid to Google it, because, like, Jimmy sussed it on the laptop. That'd be kind of hard to explain. So I thought, there's only one thing for it. I'll get a smartphone. Jimmy kicked off, of course. What do you want one of them for? Can't the Nokia do you? There's an app you can get, Baby Centre. All your pregnancy questions answered. For fuck's sake, don't stress me out, Jimmy. Says it's a very helpful tool for the mindful mother. He had to buy it for me then, didn't he? Now, the coverage isn't great. Helps if you hold it up in the air, but I'm after getting some deadly ideas. Poison. It's the only way to go. Rolled barley. Cows go mad for it, but it's real bad for them. So if she munches on that for an hour even, it'll blow up, ferment in her gut, and she's done for. And do you know what she'll end up dying of? Alcoholic poisoning. Even if the vet pumps her out, it'll do no good. Damage done, she'll just pine away. And the best bit, Jimmy mixes it in with the pig feed anyway, so there's bags of it in the shed already. Cows are curious, do you know? Everyone would think she just nosed about and ate it herself. It's genius.
Pure feckin' genius. Feck you, Breeda. Who needs to leave and cert? Hush, little baby, don't be afraid. Mammy's going to murder the sheriff. And if they wonder where she went, I'll say, I don't know. And I'm pregnant. And then maybe Breeda will die. I hope you're not born with her gammy eyes. Jimmy, when are we going to tell Breeda? I'm blue in the face from asking him. I think he'd be as happy just ambling along, saying nothing, till either she copped it, or worse, someone in the town did and the rumours got going. I'd be bunched if she found out that way. I can't have that happening. I don't like it in him that he won't tell her. Promise me he would. That's worrying. I don't like it. And in the meantime, there's me traipsing up and down from town every day, me back killing me, me boobs rock hard out to here. This is not going to plan. Jimmy, when are we going to tell Breeda? Huh? We've time enough yet, Siobhan. I nearly 16 weeks, Jimmy. Jimmy! I'm marching in there right now and telling her myself if you won't do it. Ah, look. You've not to go upsetting her before we go off the knock. It's her only holiday. We'll tell her after. Can't you let her enjoy knock? Fuck knock, Jimmy. And he bursts out laughing at me, reaches up for a hug the way he does, be trying to get around me when I cross. That's not going to work this time, Jimmy. I'm telling her, and I'm telling her now, come with me if you want. Being pregnant feels a bit like being possessed. You do mad things. Breeda takes it real bad. Roaring, crying, cursing me, him, her terrible lot in life. Whinging and whining. Talking forwards and back in the chair like she's had a feckin' wake or something. Off she went, round one. The neighbours, the town, the rumours, the shame, the ICA, the priest. In that order. I said nothing. Round two. Poor her. How would she hold her head up? Hadn't she raised him better? His father would be ashamed. He wouldn't look at me after that. Round three. I'm a hussy. And a trollop. Took advantage. No morals. What could she expect coming from where I do? Stupid. No education. Tick. Too tick to take precautions. Ugly. Lazy. Knew which side my bread was buttered. No fear. Stupid. 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 I stayed quiet. But my cheeks started to burn up the more she said it. I bunched up my fist. Digging the nails into me palm, staring at the kitchen table, shaking, genuinely getting ready to punch her in the head. When the most amazing thing happened. The baby kicked me. Something came over me. I looked her straight in the eye. The good eye. It's all right, Breeda. I don't want Anton. I'm not looking for a handout. I'm leaving here. Leaving the town. Nothing to keep me here if you won't accept your own flesh and blood. That fairly put a halt to our gallop. Where will you go, Siobhan? I don't know, Breeda. I don't know. But we'll be fine. Me and the baby. We'll never bother you or Jimmy again. Grab me cardigan. I can feel Jimmy's eyes on me going through me, but I made myself not look at him. When I get to the door, his voice cracks at me, "Wait, Siobhan." And I turn back to see this giant, giant man, a grown man, who
who should be so clear and strong and easy in himself. But he's paralyzed. And I think it's so easy. It's so easy, Jimmy. Just stand up to her once. Trust what you're feeling and come get me. It's what you want. But I won't do it for you. If you can say all that with a look. And I think you can. Can be parting shot. It's all right, Breeda. Don't worry. I'm not come looking for this little one's inheritance. No, this little baby will never know anything about this farm. Or any farm. Or country life. Or anything. I walk out, like in slow motion, out into the lashing rain. In 30 seconds I'm soaking and I haven't even got to the end of the lane. It's pitch black, but I know the road well. And I'm in floods of tears for a second and then... totally fine. Relieved, nearly. My cardigan smells like a wet dog. And then headlights from behind. Jimmy pulls alongside me in the Jeep. Get in. No, cop on, you didn't mean it. Didn't I? No, you did not. And what you said about the baby not knowing about the farm. You didn't mean that, Siobhan. We don't want that, we. I waited. But he says nothing. God, he hasn't a clue. Oh, are you all right? What's wrong, Siobhan? Nothing. The baby kicked me, is all. And his face crumbles. But he looks away. So I take aim. I can hug myself now, Jimmy. And he breaks down and cries and cries. Head on the steering wheel, sobbing from his guts. It was the hardest thing I ever done, just letting him alone, crying. I don't want to have him hurting, but I don't want to feel this bad the rest of my own life. So I let him cry it all out. Eventually he kind of comes to, wipes his nose on the back of his hand. I'm going to go now, Jimmy. She can give me a lift to town, though, if you want. Okay. I get in, and he looks at me, kind of shakes himself. Ah, look, this is not what you want. This is mad. You're coming back with me, Siobhan. Stop all this. Look, I want you to come home with me. Me. All right. Come on and we go back home, Siobhan. The three of us. All right? All right. Slept in the spare room that night. Moved me stuff in the next day. Breeda couldn't let it go without a swipe. Better than having you parading round the town. I stared at her. Shush, Mum, Jimmy said. I said nothing.
Margarita.
and having to take me time with everything now. Just getting from the bed to the bog is a big job. And I feel like I'm wading through a slurry pit. The air is so thick around me bump. I kind of feel a bit graceful, like a dancer. Moving with presence and purpose, they say at yoga. I like yoga, but they talk an awful lot of bullshit too. I caught sight of myself yesterday real early in the morning when I got up for a wee. Passing by the mirror, me belly sticking right out, me head turned to the side. I look beautiful like this. I got a fright, like it wasn't even me. I had to stop and keep staring, trying to put me finger on what it is. Me face is strong, of a real straight forehead, and me head is after growing wider or something. The bump is a lovely shape, and it's hard. It's perfect. There's no lumps, just a long curvy line. And it's so big now that me legs have to be far apart the whole time so I can walk. Me skin's like the sand on British beach on the most sunniest day ever. I don't know. I'm HD or something. I feel something warm coming down me leg. I get an awful fright thinking something's gone wrong with the baby. What if I look down and there's blood? I think I might die. I think I might die if that happens. No, 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 no! I love this baby, I love her. I don't know how I made myself look in the end, but I did. There's no blood, but I'm wet all right. I was standing staring for so long, I was after weeing myself. Oh, Jesus Christ! Oh, that brought me to my senses fairly quick. I washed myself off at the sink. I couldn't really have a shower that early. I'd wake them all up and I didn't want them knowing I'd wet myself. Take another look in the mirror. See, am I still a ride? Yeah, still there, all right. This is feckin' brilliant. And I think I'll make a good mum. I like living here. It's nice having people around, you know. Breed and myself kind of steer clear of each other during the day, but I've started watching the soap, so we'll have something to talk about. She thinks I'm mad into Coronation Street, and I get to put my feet up in the only warm room in the house. Tea and buns in the ads. I do still think it's stupid that I can't stay in the one room with Jimmy, though. I mean, for Jesus' sake, the damage is done, like. But I say nothing. Our house, our rules. That'll all change when the baby's born. He won't be spending as much time up in that field looking after his perfect cow and her bump, giving her rubs. Every single thing I tell him about the baby, he has to bring it back to that bloody heifer. Did you know, Siobhan, that a cow's gestation period is 9 months as well? No, Jimmy, I didn't. And I don't give a shite! I keep thinking of the last time I slipped into the bed beside him and he pulled me close. Breeda snoring her head off next door. But that hasn't happened for ages. He says he's afraid he'll hurt the baby. Sometimes, at night, I pad across the landing and creep into his room just to have a look at him. I don't try and wake him. I just want to take him in. This strong, heavy thing unconscious in front of me. He's like a fucking gorgeous lump. And I'm standing there with that feeling like you get when you think you might jump off the balcony at mass. Like I might shout out loud or explode or disappear. I want to squeeze him that much. And then I worry I feel the same way about the baby and accidentally kill it. I'd be gone out of my mind altogether if it wasn't for this owl app. It's great for telling you what's normal. I'm addicted to it. At 29 weeks, your baby is about the size of a butternut squash and will double in size between now and the birth. Jesus. She has started to develop hair and eyebrows and may respond to sound and light. Look, Jimmy, Breda, look! Is that an elbow or a foot? The two of them jump up excited like little kids and bend over me bump. And for a second, it's really lovely. It's like how me mum and dad would be if they were here, making me feel special. Jimmy's eyes are dancing when he looks at me. Do you want to feel it? You too, Breda, go on. I pull me top up a bit, but Breda makes a face and this horrible noise. Jimmy goes red. All of a sudden, they won't look at me anymore or each other, and they sit back down either side of the fire and say nothing for ages. I fix myself. Close my eyes, pretend to do me breathing. I want to cry. I'm so stupid for even trying. Eventually, Jimmy asks me what's wrong, but I don't want to let the tears out, so I snap at him. Heartburn, headache, back pain, bloating, leg pain, constipation, piles, cystitis, take your pick. Could be worse, says Breda. Poor Charolais has mastitis. Now, if you had that, you'd know all about it. And Jimmy jumps up, I'll head to the vets, get her some antibiotics. You'd want to hear the relief in him to be getting out of here for a while. And I think that is it. This is the final straw. I cannot take this anymore. I'm doing it now. I mightn't get another chance before the baby arrives. I'm putting her and her mastitis out of their misery. I'm going for a walk, Breda. Clear me head. I grabbed a knife on the way out the back door and head looking for the Charolais. Jimmy's had her close to the yard for the last few weeks, but I can't see her, and he'll be back in an hour. It's too risky bleeding her out, but I can make the cut at least. Rub dirt or muck or, I don't know, a rusty pipe off it or something. I can't find her and I need to do it quick. And then I hear a moo coming from the shed. The same shed that she watched us all them months ago, and I just know it's her. She's facing me when I get to the door. It's like she knew I was coming. I never take my eyes off her. Keep the blade out of sight. All I have to do is get her into the crush. I move in a step. She tosses her head back into the side. The hair on her neck is so silky, I nearly want to touch it. And then I think, sure, I can do that when she's dead. She snorts out a heavy breath at me, and her eyes seem to fix on me bump. And then she bawls out this awful groan from the bottom of her guts and lies down in front of me in the muck and the manure. Jesus Christ! She's having the calf! Oh my God! The side of her head is on the ground. One of her back legs is raised up in the air. The water bag is out and burst long ago, I'd say, by the look of her. God, Jesus, there's two small hooves sticking out her back end. I don't know what to do. I think for a second. What if I do nothing? I could just walk away. Problem solved, maybe. And then she raises her head up and stares straight at me, pleading with me. I can see it in her eyes. The baby's doing somersaults inside me and I've no choice. I run to the house, shouting, Breda! Come on, now! The Charolais is calving, but there's something wrong. I tried, Jimmy. It's gone straight to voicemail. We get to the shed and Breeda hands me the glove. I don't fucking believe this. I'll talk you through it, she says. Well, you had better. Stick your hand in there. Feel for his mouth. Is he moving? Is he alive? She pushes this metal yoke, the calving jack, up against the cow's rear end, slips the ropes over his hooves and onto the jack, and the two of us grab hold of the lever and pull and pull. And each time the cow pushes, we pull the calf a little further out, holding him there for her till the cow strains again. And we're going grand, I think, till something's wrong. The legs are out, but the head won't come any further. I don't think I can go on. I'm 7 months pregnant, for God's sake. I can't do this. Listen to me. If you want to be a farmer's wife, you'll show me what you're made of. So we pull. And pull. Again and again. Not letting up till eventually the head comes clear. I take a deep breath, hold me muscles tight. Thank God for me core and me pelvic floor. And then out comes the rest of him with so much shouting and roaring between us and terrible noises from the cow. I tell you one thing. I'm having an epidural. End of. We drag him out at last, and Breeda falls up against the wall exhausted. But I've never seen her smile like this. I pulled the little fellow ways up the shed. He's snow white. Well, like underneath all the blood and mucusy stuff and all. He's gorgeous. Little black eyes real far apart. You can admire him later, says Breeda. Get the iodine and spray his navel. Quick, quick, now, before the cow gets back to her feet. I can hardly bear to take my eyes off. But I get it like she says, because we don't want him getting an infection. He's so lovely. And suddenly, there's Jimmy, standing at the door, beaming at the two of us. Well, no, the four of us. What the fuck? You're two mad women. There's grown men have heart attacks calving a cow, not to mind a 72-year-old woman and a pregnant lunatic. Well, you are no help to anyone, says Breeda, and your phone turned off. She's some woman, this girl of yours. She meant me. We done the whole thing right, Jimmy, and look at him, he's perfect. And he is. He's perfect. And this is perfect. Everything's perfect. That's what I'm thinking to myself as I walk over to the calf, bend down and squirt his belly button with the brownie red spray. And you know them times that it's so big, your brain has to slow down to make sense of it. I spray his belly and rub his head. In a few hours he'll be a velvety little thing running round the place. He gives a little call, flash of his pink tongue. The straw under him is yellow. Blood in me apron. Me wellies are green. Suddenly there's a commotion coming from the far end of the shed. I stand up straight. Jimmy's eyes are wide open. He's waving his arms and shouting something.
Oh God, the Charolais charging. Head down, coming straight for me and the calf. I know I should run, but I'm stuck to the spot. This huge, hairy juggernaut thing all flashing white thunder coming to do me in. I can't move. I brace myself. When you're dead, just gone. I wonder, will the baby live? Then I feel something at me arm. Breeda's small hands push me out of the way and I fall backwards away from the calf. Her glasses fly off as her tiny frame is lifted into the air in front of me eyes. There's a sound like sticks crackling in the fire.
Jesus!
I think it might be Breeda's ribs crunching up as the cow crushes her against the concrete wall. Her eyes are open and there's blood coming out her ear. But we can't get close to do anything because the cow has her pinned and she's squishing all the breath out of her. But you can tell by the angle of her head that her neck's broke anyway, so... We just stand there staring. I feel Jimmy's hand in mine and he walks me backwards to the end of the shed, watching the cow the whole time. We stood there holding hands with each other and he calls an ambulance.
Oh, I mean, she was dead, no question.
But we didn't know what else to do and we couldn't get close till the cow was finished with her, so we just held hands.
I should have been here, he says.
Not your fault, Jimmy. How is it your fault? If anything, it's my fault for going near the calf. Actually, it's Breeda's for telling me to. But I don't think now is the time to say that. Eventually, the cow moves away from Breeda, starts licking the calf clean, till he's up on his feet, staggering around looking for his first feed. Slowly, gently, Jimmy opens the side gate and guides the two of them into the old milking shed. Comes back in, locks the gate and turns to me. I think I might have to sell that cow. I think that's the right thing to do, Jimmy. Jesus, she didn't think twice about killing poor Breeda. I mean, that's demented. We've this baby to think of now. You can't have that kind of carry on around children. Jimmy, I'm not sure we can call the baby Charolais after all this either.
Thank Christ for that, he goes.
And the two of us burst out laughing. We're roaring, laughing. We can't stop. Tears and everything. Till he looks back at Breeda. And then he's crying. And I just hold on to him. I even have a little cry myself. You know what?
I do love you, Siobhan.
Sure, I know that. And then I let him there for a little minute to say goodbye to his mammy by himself. Spot the knife on the way out the door. And as I bend down to pick it up, I catch sight of Breeda's glasses smashed up in the blood and the straw. And I can't help thinking to myself in a weird way. It might have been how she would have wanted to go. No, like saving the baby and all. Sure, she wasn't the worst. Poor old Breeda.
fine. The three of us. Do-do. L'enfant d'eau. L'enfant d'eau.